phone's gonna record, so it's gonna.
Well, beyond that, you know, I don't even know how long it's going for. It's a new battery. So. Every time that Matt takes a bite, you have to ask questions and talk about yourself.
It's like a drinking game.
They're healthy and less fun.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, I got a salad. But if Greg didn't take me to the pub.
Yeah, I was going to say that at Guinness, does that count?
Yeah, yeah.
We need that one carrot piece at a time.
That was a question. That was a question.
Yeah, that's a great
question.
So first thing is just to introduce yourselves, you know, who you are, what your studio is, and what you're thinking about doing, and regardless of whether it's clear or not, just, you know, where you're at this moment.
Thanks, Greg.
In the form of a question.
Want to make lots of for you.
In the form of a question.
Fully supportive.
Starting
with you. Yeah. Right.
So I have no time to think about it. All right. Chantel Polches. Well, I work with metals. I'm trying to do 3D printing for see where that goes.
Okay, and then we'll add one more thing to this. And a problem you're having, you know, a challenge you're experiencing. So just one challenge, whatever it is, big or small. Also give you a context of, you know, where they are at and there.
So you guys are all recent grads, right?
Except for one.
2 years ago?
That's recent.
2 years ago.
Yeah.
1 year ago? 2 years ago.
2 years
ago? 2 years ago, I think.
Yeah, a year and a half.
Year and a half. Okay.
Yeah. I think most of you came to the studio.
Yes, Jan hadn't come back to Canada yet, so we can miss him. And there's a couple who are in the low res program residency, and so on. Okay, so one problem, one challenge.
Business things, I guess, like social media and websites and, you know, presenting myself in that way. It's hard. Because, like, I feel like I'm focusing a lot on just the production of it.
What was it?
Metal. This is beginning to sound like you.
Yeah. See, here, I got a t-shirt with you, like, yeah. Back to Platoon.
Rory Metal, I haven't gotten any grants, but your concern is?
Oh, I guess two of them is I have some stuff in I want to have cast, and I'd like to show it to you, so you can tell me if I'm going to send it away, that how polished, how finished I can get to look. So I think the one question to the life and not the work is maybe sometimes is, you know, shed some light on what you do to make the process that is boring or becomes boring interesting again. So casting and then you're polishing and you're doing repetitive things is how do you not lose sight of, you know, because you're always going to have things you want to do, and how do you keep that from not trailing into disinterest and, oh, I'm just going to get this case book because I want it, and you know, you really shit yourself because you're just not going to work. How do, you know, how do you just keep those guardrails up to the end of the project? And so that's I think, the wandering and being disinterested in the line, it will happen as it goes along in the points, and just how do you bring it back to focus. That would be the biggest help.
My name is Amanda. I'm in the ceramics program. And my main issue right now is just finding a glaze that works with my pots. I forgot.
I'm Nicole. I'm in fashion. And I'm working this year on like historical stuff, but also putting together kind of a resume application, I guess, because I want to do the education program at either your senior or senior next year. So I'm kind of working on that and also historical. I guess my struggle is just the fact that I completely changed what I wanted to do so far this year, so trying to get that underway and like figure out exactly what I'm spending my year doing is time management, I guess, and trying to figure out exactly how to keep motivated at a project until it's completed. Same kind of like what you were just saying, like you get disinterested and you want to work on something else. So that's
what I'm doing. I'm really working on 3D printing and casting. And I suppose my biggest concern at the moment is when I just started printing and I'm finding it difficult to get the texture right because you can add texture to 3D printing now. And I suppose my biggest concern is just, you know, getting it perfect so I can print a lot of them at once so then I can cast them and then I can actually get production on one way. So right now I'm kind of in a stance until it's ready to get.
I'm Catherine. I'm also in jewelry. I'm focusing on doing pop-ups this year, so I'm hoping to have my first pop-ups in December, and I will do at least one more by the end of the school year. My struggle at the moment is just kind of getting everything together so that the pop-up can happen, because there's so many things that need to get done, so just, you know, making it happen.
My name is Yamcha. I graduated 2 years ago and I came back to Korea and I went to more opportunity to get and I applied this program. When I in the exhibition in UAP, I found very good things. I took picture. Today I know you can see.
Yeah, right.
Yes, I'm like surprised. I have one question. Usually, if we have a job and go to the workplace and come back home and very regular after working, we have time with family or support. When workplace working and hometown, we have to very different to come and very regular. You are artist and you have more free time. When you work in place, how can you spend your time in getting working all day you cannot take your children what you have. Take up your pain. People, you're not interested in making art. Their life is not regular. Very, sorry, I cannot English very well.
No, keep working on it. We'll figure it out. Keep going.
So, very regular working is very good for health or for mind or for spirit. But in my case, if I have all free time, I have to control my time all day. How can you control your time and control your daily life? I have another question. If a woman is okay, just support family and they have artist job. But men very different support family. How can you support your family? Where do you get your income? Can support your my experience, to support family, make money or labor. This is, I think, a very important thing.
So just for clarification, are you talking about some kind of job so to support family and life? And how do you have time for creative work?
Control own time.
Control your own time.
For example, in the workplace, if I have a job in company, works work very hard. Compared to home, I have relaxed time.
Right. Then relaxed time. And you,
yes.
So that's a balance.
Yes.
Work, relax.
Yes. Your artist,
right, self-employed artist,
all time yourself, how control your time, or the routine time, and how can you support?
Yeah,
no, that's a real concern for sure.
Can you understand?
Yeah. Because you don't have to sort of manage your own schedule. And there's a lot of other demands. One of the things that surprised me when I started doing art full time, and I think I first noticed it when I took a workshop from Peter Pounder, who most of you will know his work. He started off as a potter, doing selling at the market, rocks and bowls and things like that in the 70s. And sort of as his career evolved, he's been doing a lot more large sculpture work. Corporate commissions and things like that, large pieces of the N.B. Powers, a big sculpture up front, N.B. Powers, which is just a big lightning bolt. And I remember him describing the process of making that piece. Because when you're a student, I sort of got the impression that I was going to spend all my time making things, sitting in the studio and creating all the time. I didn't quite get the reality of just how much time you have to spend doing that things in order to make that work. And so Peter was describing how, with this particular piece, he had spent, I don't know how many hours getting the job, getting a grant to do it, or the job, I guess it was.
The contract.
And his part in the process was mostly taking a napkin at lunch and scribbling a line, and then from there, because these things are massive, it's the size of the You know, so all of that work is outsourced. You know, then it's finding the subcontractors who are going to weld these giant pieces of steel together, and, you know, hiring that crane that's going to lift it into place, and, you know, hiring an engineer to make sure it's not going to fall over, and all of that sort of thing. And so for a job like that, you may not be spending any time in the studio. He's got sort of a more successful career, and he's built his way up to that. But,
5 minutes of creativity.
You know, I don't know if that's typical of what he does, but yeah, it's 5 minutes of creativity and then a lot of managing
weeks.
And phone calls and emails and stuff like that, and then a big paycheck at the end. I think the statistic that he gave to us was that he spent 80% of his time doing administrative tasks and 20% working in the studio, which it wasn't what I signed up for. Like, I went into art school because I wanted to be an artist, because I wanted to spend all of my time, you know, doing something that I enjoyed. And I had the experience of having a few crappy jobs, which were you know, shoveling dirt or loading fish onto trucks or things like that. So I kind of knew what I didn't want to do, and I knew what I really enjoyed. But it wasn't immediately apparent, just all the other things that go into making that a possibility. So I think I try and aim for about 50% of my time in the studio and 50% doing other things, because there's a lot of other things that need to be done. I mentioned social media, and there's emails and accounting and grant writing and all of that stuff. And, you know, like I said earlier, a lot of that stuff is on paper, so the money has to come from somewhere when you're trying to make that a lifestyle, you know, where it's sustainable. It's easy to get excited about a project and sign up to do something that's going to be a whole lot of fun, but not a lot of pay. You can only do that so many times before you realize that, you know, your bills aren't getting paid. You know, you've got people knocking on your door. So finding that work-life balance is important. You know, how much time do you spend in the studio, and how much time is trying to sell that? Is it a good use of your time to try and apply for grants? Is it a good use of time to design something in a CAD program versus carbon and wax? All of these questions are hopefully become apparent. For me, I enjoy the hands-on process of working with paint or wax or whatever it is I'm doing. So I tend to shy away from jobs that are sitting in front of the computer. I already do a lot of that stuff just with using a website or social media or something. But the CAD opens up a lot of possibilities for things that I would be able to make by hand, you know, would be able to carve, or it would just take too long to carve, and it'd be faster to do it with the CAD program. But what it comes down to is, like, what do you enjoy doing? Where do you enjoy spending your time? That's part of the fun for you. That's great. But yeah, also, you know, it's not an easy way to make a living necessarily. There's easier ways that you can raise, you know, make money to raise a family and, you know, establish, you know, working hours and things like that. And I tend to tell people that if there's something else that you could be doing, like if you can enjoy having a job, doctor or something like that. And if that, you know, having that, you know, money or that lifestyle is important to you, then, you know, consider those options. Don't see, you know, or being a teacher, you know, don't see, you know, having spent several years at craft college as a waste of your time. You can think of it as, you know, this is a process of finding out what you want to do for the next 10 years or for the next 20 years or for the rest of your life. And some people are content to do the same thing for the rest of their lives. But it's not the easiest way to make money. You can be happy doing something else. Worth consideration for sure. And if you're not sure about what you want to do, don't see this as like, I'm going to do jewelry for the rest of my life. See it as, I'm going to do it for now and then see where it leads, because something else is going to open up and something else is going to inspire you and motivate you. And those skills that you learn here or in the jewelry studio, those carry over to whatever else you choose to do, whether it's teaching or some other form.
Do you think it's a difficult way to make a living because of the extra work you had to put into it and you didn't know up front, and you had to learn the skills and dealing with land and taxes, and you didn't know that how much you were going to have to do. And it's difficult because you're saying over 50% of the business is working with other people, not doing the work. And you might necessarily, if you didn't learn in college, we have one class that was on business and taxes, but it's so do you think maybe part of the difficulty is the learning curve after you finish school? Not necessarily, the money could be there, but it's difficult because you've got to learn quite a bit about how to get that money. It's not just about the work.
Well, it's true that you have to wear a lot of hats as an artist. You don't only have to be very good at what you do, but then you also have to be able to make a living, to be able to write grants and take photographs. All of those other things, do the books and stuff like that. And, the college, I'm sure, has done a good job for a lot of us. Even with one business class, that's a good start. Those things, are still part of your activity. Don't necessarily know how to do it.
For the cost of things. Polishing wheel, you go buy one, oh shit.
Yeah, $1,000.
That stuff for free. Yeah, it's a shock.
Yeah.
Where does that money come from?
That's true. Yeah, and the way I did it, I sort of touched on it earlier, was that I started off with just little minimal tools. But one of the sort of discouraging things that I can get around to talking about, when I was at school, I spent part of my student loan on tools. And gemstones. And when I first moved out on my own, after I graduated, I had a studio that was in a shared space where I was subletting a little studio from a larger building. And one day I walked in to find out all my tools and stones were gone. And I really felt like I was starting back at square one. Discouraging, I had to sort of just accept that that was the reality, rather than being a victim of that, just to start from scratch. For a long time, like I said, I made copper jewelry, I made old electrical wire or whatever, and turned into something that was 25 cents worth of materials. $100 worth of tools into, which I still have 20 years later, it's the second round of wires and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Kept a closer eye on it since then. But, start with very little and then build something like that. It's a mistake, I think, to go big and to spend a lot of money on stuff. I would plan to go forward from there.
Mm-hmm.
Starting from minimal sort of resources, you have to learn to be creative and learn all the skills. You got to deal with people and get paid. There's no right or wrong way maybe to do it. To become an artist,
yep.
to follow your aspirations. There's no more than one path for sure to find success quickly and right away. And people maybe they have to, or maybe they have to suffer through their whole career. It's always interesting stories about painters or something, parents or using their old bed sheets to as canvas, you know. So because for them and for a lot of people, they recognize that this is something that they have to do. You know, there's not really another option in terms of what your career is going to be. If you're going to be miserable and, you know, not enjoy working for someone else or in an office or something like that, if being an artist sounds like it's, you know, worth the struggle, that's kind of the path. I think for me, I've given it a lot of thought because I went through periods where, you know, I don't have the money to pay rent or buy materials or something like that. It's like, you know, this is the career for me. It's what I want to be doing. But it's, life may be easier if I found an alternative.
Mm-hmm.
And it always comes back to, you know, this is what I want to do. I've got to find a way. If something's not working, if something's, not paying off, if it's eating up my time and not giving a return, then what do I need to change about that? What's a different direction that I can choose? And I might have mentioned this one else. When you guys were at the studio, but for a few years, I had something on which worked well for me. There was a website online which was custom work. I'm still getting a little work from it, but you know, in contrast to Etsy or somewhere where you make things and put it on and then people go on and buy it, which is one way of doing it. Works, you know, works for some people. This would be like the customer goes on, presents their idea or something that they want to have, whether it's jewelry, woodworking. You know, those tend to be two of the more popular ones, but you know, there's no reason it couldn't be fashion or pottery or something like that. You know, the work quite well for jewelry because, you know, I can go on. Even if I was low on money, especially when I was low on money, I'd go on, find a few jobs, present a proposal, give them a quote, and then, you know, sometimes within a few hours or two, and that's back and forth, you don't get paid because you get at least a deposit.
Mm-hmm.
So then you've got money for materials, and when you're working with gold and diamonds especially, it becomes important to get that money ahead of time because I still can't afford to buy a credit card or something. I hope that it's going to pay off and, you know, get a customer. When it doesn't pay, can it pay or something like that? You're up Schitt's Creek, you know. You kind of get a deposit. Usually, that's what I found. What was great about the site was that, you know, you could go on and really drive a business without a lot of effort. You don't have to get out of your pajamas. You don't have to go to the show and set up. Those, you know, those things are great too. But in January or February or something like that, where there's nothing going on, there's no sales from galleries coming in, there's no Christmas sales are done. You know, maybe you have a few commissions or something like that. Maybe you can make some cash if it's good for that. But the point of the story that I'm telling is that those things come and go. You know, maybe those things work for a while. In this case, what I've done with that site wasn't quite clear at the time, but has become a clearer sense, is that the website was charging artists a portion of the sales, so 10% to the website. You know, it's free to host the website and hire the staff and stuff like that. It was almost a victim of its own success in the sense that the shareholders or whoever is in charge of the website realized that there was more money to be made if they just had rather than independent craftspeople, you know, all over North America making work. So they sort of took over the process of when customers go to the website, and take them through the process of designing. You know, they'd have a jewelry designer whose job was just to design the jewelry. And then they have their own team of jewelers, which would make the pieces and initiative. So that site sort of evolved into a different business model, which, you know, unfortunately for all the people who, you know, were benefiting from sort of missed out on that opportunity. But what I'm saying is that you just have to accept those things and move on and find a different avenue for selling things. Some things are going to work for a while, but things go out of style. Your galleries close. Or they move on to other artists, or they don't promote your work as much as it needs to be, or whatever. I think that being adaptable and, you know, just opening yourself up to new opportunities, better opportunities, and then, you know, seeing where that takes you is a good way of going, but not to the point where have control over your career and you don't push that in a certain direction, but just being able to go on a little
bit. Strategically, the direction, you decide direction by, because what I get from you is you've got the love for metal and what you're doing in the center, and you try to adapt to keep that as, you're always going to make stuff. Adapt. So as you're deciding, you need to adapt to market or customer, or do you decide that financially or emotionally? Because we all have lines, we've all done shit that we really like that everybody else hates, or it just doesn't work out, or too technically difficult, and the customer that we're looking for, we don't know, we can't find them, and the people we know won't pay for it. Is that an emotional decision when you say, okay, I know this is good, it feels good, but I can't do it? Or is it, you would be feel financially irresponsible taking one line in a completely different direction, and it would be exploratory and waste of time to do that? Is it more, you know what I'm saying, is it more emotional? Or, because we can all do stuff, the love of the art is there, we can do that and be hungry. You know, not a lot of money is what we're doing, but I'm just, is there a cutoff point for you, and you say, where does it come from?
Yeah, there is. I mean, like, you know, I tend to make decisions based on impulse or based on emotion. But it always has to be like that other voice in the back of your head that's like, is this a good idea, or are you gonna be able to eat next week? You know, if you do what it is you want to do. But then you also have to be able to take some risks when you're calculating. If you confine yourself to, you know, make a product line and work and selling or whatever, but it's maybe not inspiring anymore, so it's not enjoyable for you to do. There's, you know, you have to find the line that's right for you.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yep.
And everyone's got a different personality and everyone's got a different approach. I think that there has to be a little bit of both. There has to be the motivation and inspiration to do what you do and to keep coming and keep enjoying it. And then also, you know, the compromise. You know, you've got to be able to make something that's saleable. So, and it changes all the time, you know, it's always changing, and opportunities come up where, you know, like you get a chance to do something that's really exciting, or maybe take those opportunities, even if they're, you know, not gonna, even if they're just gonna sort of pay minimum wage or whatever, but yeah, there's a point where it's like, you know, you're working for a year or something, and obviously you can't do that too many times.
There's something in your example that you said earlier, which was you're talking about taking on a commission, and you know, you maybe have 75% knowing what you're doing, and then there's this big, I mean, 25% to pull this off. So one thing you were saying, you were encouraging people to do that, or take a chance, and a lot of what that has to do with is actually trusting that you'll figure it out. We don't actually need to know everything. And part of that, trusting oneself to figure it out, is in a sense trusting that you'll know which way of the line you need to go on right now. Is it the experimental adventure, or is it the I need to buy food for next week type thing? But I think that, but bigger than that is, the creative mind wants to do certain things, but if we don't trust our innate abilities, we won't actually give that thought the seriousness that it deserves. That, you know, in terms of pushing into it, trying something out, taking that opportunity that's coming by, and second guess ourselves if we don't grab it. I think that's a big issue around being able to have a flexible relationship to basically the artist's life. It is always changing. As opposed to being afraid of that, it's more trusting your ability to respond. What do you think of that?
Yeah, I'll give another example, a more recent example, which is, you know, a couple weeks ago, I was approached about making an award on very short notice. It's sort of a week to complete this award. And it was, you know, certain conditions were stipulated that they wanted to be bronze, half bronze, and it was going to be engraved. And so the rush was that to have the inscription engraved in it. And so I only had a week, and I, you know, the first 4 or 5 days of that week were already booked, you know, like already booked. And I said, well, yeah, you know, I'll take it on, and you know, my first instinct, which was, you know, to make a bronze hollow-ware sculpture, I guess. And what I often do when I get a custom job is a certain guess, and I say, what the budget is going to be, like what, you know, fair, how much to afford, when you're working with companies or corporations, and you usually have a set budget. In this case, it was $800, which I think is pretty standard for one, at least the ones that I've done.
Yeah, but the 1 week timeline isn't
the 1 week.
Standard.
Well, yeah, it definitely isn't.
That doubles the cost.
Yeah, I think so. Something that's not there actually.
Yeah, and typically, you know, you want to charge extra for custom work. Right. When you're doing custom work, it's basically like every project is new. You know, sometimes you're doing things that you've never done before. You're getting equipment that you've never used before. Not got experience, and so there's a bit of a learning curve for you. And so, and the other difference, of course, is that when you're doing production line, when you're doing production work, you're making 10 or 20 or more pieces all at once. So you don't have to stop every couple of minutes and retool. You know, you're working on it. You're bring out and file out, just work on filing 20 prints, and then you move on to the next step. You save a lot of time in the process, because you're just a lot more efficient. So that's the reason for, you know, the cost of custom work being higher. And so if you're going to get into custom work, try and get twice as much for it. What happened in this case with the reward is that, you know, I thought, well, okay, got a short time, I'll stop up this shop downstairs and get a piece of bronze. And, you know, my first instinct was just to build this thing while, you know, 12 hours into making the work, and I'm already on like sort of a two-day time schedule. I realized that my initial idea wasn't going to work out. You know, I was having trouble with just the scale of it, you know, like it was about 12 inches tall, and so, you know, my torches aren't hot enough. Warping and turning into a big drum. So I, you know, realized with, you know, sort of 12 hours to go before the thing's getting picked up, that I could sort of take a step back and reevaluate the approach. So, you know, I went digging through my wood pile and found some pieces of walnut that I could pull together. And then, you know, fortunately, had a sheet of brass which was all scratched up and kicked around for a few years. But, you know, nothing that so I'm gonna polish out. I think, you know, with 12 hours ago, started over. Well, you know, worked 24 hours straight, but in the end, you know, pulled it off. Happy with what I came up with. The customer was happy with it. The first rule, I know I'd forgotten the first rule to customer was just to keep it simple. You know, it's not always an opportunity do something that's exciting and not done, you know, this you know, brand money basically. So, and then hopefully that's going to free up some time for, you know, doing something you enjoy. But, you know, in this case, I had to make toys. So, in the end, it was enough
basically. Is to what Craig was saying about having the 75% trust in 25%? Is there a certain spot in the journey of the creation from the idea to the customer that you find you have that 25% really starts? Because I'm good at the designing, but finding where my customer is, I think, you know, I don't know who wants this. And that's where I choke. And I was wondering if you noticed that about yourself in the career started early. Was there a spot? You were good up to a certain spot then.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, finding the market for more expensive pieces and larger projects and stuff like that, you know, the larger it gets, the narrower people have that sort of income, it's expendable. And I think it just takes time to get oriented into it. Starting small is my advice to start off. And then customers come to you, you know. At first, I sort of had a policy where I didn't like to turn away money if someone, you know, brought me an idea and it was like, you know, I could make a few dollars at it or you know, I had a chance to you know, be in my studio rather than flip burgers or something like that. That was, you know, was my policy that I'll take that on. And then eventually, you know, that included repairs, which I've always struggled with a little bit, because if you've done repairs, jewelry repairs, you know, there's not usually anything creative about the process or necessarily enjoyable. It's strictly, you know, to do this for the $40 or the $80 or whatever. But at a certain point, if you get over doing the repairs, then you end up with a list of, you know, in my case, you know, 200 people waiting for stuff, and I'm trying to, you know, get things done quickly and turn it over. And so I just had a point. I just say I'm not going to take repairs for a while, or I'm not going to take repairs at all, or something like that, because it's taking away from the work that I want to do. So, but in terms of, like, you know, working our way into the work that you want to do, I started out selling things for $20. And then they kind of grew out of it. You know, there's a point where people don't carry around $200 in cash, like, you know, farmers market or something. So
yeah.
That's when I felt like, and it was, you know, it opened up a lot of doors for me when I was, you know, just being out there, being in the public eye and talking to people, you know, maybe doing little jobs where people before long you find that there's more opportunities that you're able to take. And then, you know, I'm sort of at the point where I have to kind of make time for the things that I want to do. There's always a line of that every time you do something like that, every time you make the sort of work that you want to do more of, you've got a photograph of that that goes in the portfolio. And those are the things that you come up with. It's not that you know the ever with the cabochon set up. It's like this is a piece that I made, you know, was enjoyable for me. And then you just build a margin.
Good photograph.
Yeah, good photograph. For sure. Yeah. And jewelry studies, I'm going to talk a lot about jewelry. I'm sure it's the same for some of the other studios as well. But jewelry is particularly hard to photograph. And, you know, I could never afford to hire a photographer to take pictures. But more than that, for the time, because usually when I complete work, it's like, you know, right before it's going to get picked up, someone's like, you know, knocking on the door, and I'm like polishing, you know, putting final polish on it, or setting stone or something like that, because you're trying to, you know, turn things around in a short enough time to make it happy with it, you know, extend the guarantee time. Which actually brings up another point, because a lot of times people will come in and be looking for a custom job, and it needs to be done right away. They want it yesterday. And then there's other people who will come, and it's kind of like, oh, you know, whenever you have time, next winter, my friends are still
working. Something you always wanted.
Like that. Yeah. Yeah. And I like working with people when, you know, there's more of a relaxed time. Usually, I say, you know, 4 weeks. It gives me time, like, it needs to be carved and cast, it gives me time to finish up whatever I'm working on. I try and group things together so that I sit for 2 or 3 days in the studio and carve wax. Either cast it myself or send it away for casting. And if you want to do that, you got to give at least 8 or 10 days. Usually it'll be back within like seven days, or 1 year or so, or extra days, just in case. And then you've got to have time to finish it up and set stones, or to order stones. One thing that I've learned is it doesn't matter how many stones you've got. You never have the one that the customer wants, you know what I mean? Like, they're always looking for something that they don't have. So you order it, and it can take two or three weeks to arrive.
Yeah.
So, you know, you can, and you know, always get a deposit in there. You know, if you've got to order something. And of course, it's not very cost efficient to order one stone and leave a deposit in there, that's 20 or something like that. And that's how you end up with way more stones. So watch out for that. I did talk a little bit about grants, and I always, you know, had some kind of a lucky relationship with grants, because what I found early on was that when I started, it was on slides, take slides of your work, then, you know, bring them into the parties or whatever to get developed. What you're getting sometimes is spend $30 on a roll of slide film, spend several hours shooting them, you know, pay to have them develop and pick them back and roll back, and you know, the power balance is off or something like that. Things have gotten a lot easier now with visual imagery. But you still can spend a lot of time photographing work, writing artist statements, writing biographies, updating your resume, you know, packaging things off, shipping things off, like easily 2 or 3 weeks into a grant proposal, and then have maybe a 25% chance of getting it. Because there's a little in New Brunswick, I'm not sure about other provinces, but I expect it's probably similar, because there is a small pool of funding that's available, and a lot of people are looking for it. So usually, it depends on the grant that you're applying for, but it's about 25%, if it's a $2,000 grant or a $1,000 grant, and you've already spent 3 weeks getting ready for it, then, when you get the grant, you kind of pay for it for time. So for a long time, I was a little hesitant to apply for grants, because you apply for a few and you don't get them, and it's like, wow, this waste time that I couldn't afford to waste, and I would be better off if I'd taken that 2 weeks or 3 weeks and just, went to the studio and spent that time. But what doesn't happen if you do that is that you don't develop your career in the sense of like getting your name out there and getting recognized. The trick I find with getting grants is that you have to prepare all that stuff, and then just, you don't have to start every time from scratch, writing a resume and put that on every year, make a point, every 6 months or 12 months, just kind of adding on the things, maybe taking off a few old things and catering that resume or CV to whatever grant you're applying for, or residency or whatever it is. But you have all of those things. You get a file on your computer of all the images of your work. When you go to apply for a creation grant or something like that, you just tinker and select the things that relate to what it is you're applying for. And then it's not a whole process of
so you find it more beneficial later on in your career to do it, or is it just
that? Yeah, I don't want to discourage you from applying for grants, but I wouldn't count on that as and then the trick is to, I found, to just send them off and forget about it. Because sometimes it's 6 months or more before you hear back from the application. So you can't be sitting around waiting for that, $2,000 to fix your car, because it's just not going to get by. And if it comes through, it comes through, then
in terms of another thing that sucks time, but is potentially career building, is competitions. And I've noticed in the metal, through other students in previous years, and things that Brigitte has encouraged people to do, there's a lot of competition in metal, a lot of opportunities. But I've watched students in this program get kind of derailed in terms of production or creating a body of work from this competition, that competition, this journey. And 5 months of stuff go by, and you get into some, you don't. But in some ways, it's that balance again. If you don't do it now, it's not coming around again until next year. So you do it now, then there's another one, and there's another opportunity. Yes, you have to balance this with your need to eat, but I think it's also, I'm asking, is there a way to decipher how many should one take, or is there, or which ones are the better ones for one's career, or the question is, what's your experience with that kind of competition?
Yeah, I'm sure there is. There's the Saul Bell Award is one of the jewelry awards that comes around every year, and it's a real brand that puts it on. And if you win an award like that, it's heavily promoted. Even if you're shortlisted, if you've got the top publishers or something like that. The name's going to get out there, and then you're going to be able to, as an independent craftsperson, promote yourself to that extent. Recognized by some of the galleries and some of the high-profile customers or whatever. So what I think I would recommend is that something that, like a competition or something like that, that works you towards that, points you in that direction. Because if you have a sort of vague idea that sometime I'd like to make it, it's probably going to stay an idea, but sort of consciously decide that this is a step towards doing that. So maybe it's a competition, maybe it's taking a workshop, maybe it's buying a piece of equipment. But there's nothing like a deadline to make it finish something. You know what I mean? Like if you're signed up for a show, and this is what I found with the painting, because when you have a list of things to do, someone waiting for something, or there's always the demands of life, or keeping your house clean for kids, or whatever the case is, then stuff tends to get put on the back burner. It's really an inspiring thing where you might never get completed, but sign up to have a show, or enter a competition or something like that. Staying inspired and staying motivated. I'm not doing the same production line all the time. One of the things that I found interesting and I thought would be a good opportunity to use all of the skills which I've developed over the years and what I would be getting into knife making. I think I'm going to talk a little bit about this at the studio, about using forging, using polishing, using woodworking, stone setting, engraving. All of those skills that you pick up along the way, doing jewelry translate well into tonight. So that's a small step where it's like, you've got 75% of the one on the other 25, and that's gonna push you onto it to something else. So going back to the photographs, so one of the issues with taking photographs of your work is that it's getting picked up or something like that. You don't always have time, especially if you're not as good at painting. That's not one of my strong points. Things tend to do a lot more like last minute because it has its pros and cons, but to have something, sometimes it's just not possible to have, say you've got a 4-week timeline or something like that, to have an extra week or a few days at the end to get the work off to the 24 for archiving it. Learning to do that yourself and getting some kind of basic equipment. I think it's been really important, especially if you're selling online, because you have to always have really good images of what you're selling online for grants or whatever. I've made a lot of pieces that just there's no record of them because they get picked up. The customers, takes off with it. Sometimes I get a chance, now that I have a phone, I can sometimes take a crappy iPhone photo of it before I use. But if you have your own setup, everything's like, I've got a light box, which, was pretty inexpensive on eBay, which has sort of daylight spectrum bulbs, enough light so that the piece is well lit, but then it's like a soft box so that there's no glaring reflections or there's no reflection of the artist
take my photograph and give him the piece of jewelry. And so pretty inexpensively set that stuff up, if you can afford it. Sort of an SLR, digital SLR, cameras, investment, macro,
which, by the way, those of us who are in the Slack bill, we had a presentation of all the parts and the grants available. One was the documentation, and they set that up because for emerging people, because they usually it was clear that they didn't have a piece of equipment, they weren't prone to emerge in a sense, you know. But one of the other piece was that they were making money, up to $2,000, they were making money available for the purchase of cameras because they recognized that that was another major roadblock to being able to do documentation work in order to access grants and for development work. So just acknowledging that Arts and is recognizing what you're saying and actually is providing funds.
Cameras, computers, like even maybe a diesel or a polisher wheel or something.
Yeah,
like that.
Yeah.
So yeah, if you have a big purchase from one of us, sometimes you just have to save up for things like, you know, I'm saving up for an anvil, like a large anvil.
Mm-hmm.
And so my way of doing that is to whatever I can pay with American cash, put it in the envelope, and that's my sort of thing. Just have to save up for a big purchase. But yeah, so that's been good to have. You know, I've got a little corner of my office set up so that all I have to do is pop a piece of jewelry and then the camera's there, the lights are there, it's all set up. It's a process. And then you don't have to edit in Photoshop or something like that to edit. Don't go out and spend $1,000 on CS5 or whatever, just get a basic conscience-free. Like sometimes mine came with a camera. The editing software is only limited to kind of intuitions. You know, select areas and choose lighting. Blending things, remove little specks of dust and stuff. I mean, photographing jewelry, one of the things is that's something like earrings or a ring or something that's this big, and then it needs to be blown up, maybe if you put on a poster or, you know, fill a monitor or something like that, so you're looking at it at, you know, 50 times the actual size of the piece, and then a little speck of dust that's on the piece of jewelry is going to show up. So, you know, software that can sort of remove those little specks of dust or something. Half hour. And those things, you know, Steve Martin, for it, but they get a lot of fun. They spend hours playing around with the photograph, trying to get it just right. But after a while, it's like a bad job.
So,
if everything's set up.
Right. So most of you took, did this in last year's course with Deborah, and there was like a workshop with Drew, right?
Mm-hmm. No?
I don't think fashion did.
2 hours.
Very little.
Oh, yeah. He just kind of.
Was through it.
Yeah.
All right, so it is something I had been meaning to think about the other night, and we have what you're talking about. There is one downstairs, right, which you use, but we also have another one that we can put in this room. I have two cameras, you know, that we can make available. You most certainly should be starting to use them, getting comfortable. So that when you have this production pieces for the sale, you're actually doing some good recording. So we'll need to talk about that. And I was thinking of getting Drew to come in and specifically working with him, in a sense, just trying to take you two notches further along, developing your skill level, which you just need to practice. And then when you identify I'm stuck here, what's the next step of knowledge I need, you know. We do have this, we've left this year, but just take our, take the skill level up. It will help a lot.
Yeah, and if you're able to, you know, sort of go through this training about stuff, that's definitely a good skill. It does, you know, save you a lot of money in the long run if you're photographing stuff. You know, if you're producing 80 or 100 pieces a year or something like that to try and pay a photographer to do all that stuff.
Yeah.
So, but more than that, it's like the time schedule. You want to just be able to, you can almost do all of these things with your iPhone. So, don't, you know, if you don't have a fancy camera or a nice app, don't use that as an excuse for not taking photographs in the future. Yeah. But because you can almost run a business just with your phone. But, you know, those things certainly make it easier, you know, having the camera. Like, in, you know, this, and Drew can tell you more about this, but in here, when you're working with your lens, it's this big on your camera, so there's lots of distortion and stuff like that if you're, you've got a nice...
Especially when you're up this close with
that or less, yeah. And that's the other thing, we won't actually let you get close enough to take really high resolution photo in some places. You know, tend to be okay, but you know, when you're photographing, you're about 6 or 8 inches.
Have you ever worked with those, it's not adapters, but the things you stick on the cameras that promoting the...
It's like a telephone thing. I have not really used those
phones.
Yeah.
Does anybody use
the extra lens?
Yeah, the extra lens gets that. They look interesting, but.
Yeah, I don't know.
It could be a gizmo.
I almost ordered one off of Wish. I've seen some reviews for some, they're pretty okay.
Yeah,
the reviews are alright.
Now, give me a year if they stick around, then it's going to be better. How much of the, if you're documenting your work, how much of the process would you take pictures of to share with people online? Because I'm wondering, at what point do you feel that people invest emotionally in you or your work, and what does that look like when you want to let people in on it? Do you start right at the design, or do you just...
Yeah, that's an important point. I think that, you know, people are really interested in seeing the process. Part of what you're selling artist is not the artwork itself, but yourself, your process, sort of the mystique of, you know, the artist or just the personal connection that people have when they purchase something from you, rather than, you know, going to Charm Jewelers or something, or, you know, especially with textiles and fashion and stuff like that. You can't compete against, you know, stuff that's been outsourced, made overseas or whatever. It's never make a living if you're trying to sell jewelry for the same price that it's sold.
Yeah.
It's been mass produced.
Steel beads.
Yeah. And but what people are looking for when they come to a craftsperson to have something made or buy something from a craftsperson is quite often, you know, the experience of So, yeah. I think that they're interested in the whole process from start to finish. They're a small people, like, you know, every step of the way.
Yeah.
Here's what I do.
Yeah.
But, you know, when I think of it, like, when I reach a point where I, you know, like what I'm seeing or I'm happy, you know, with what's happening, I'll often photograph it.
Okay, at the point where the person can sort of see.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard. It's hard, you know, for a lot of people to see something that's in the process, especially the traditional photographers. Most people are going to see work in progress. But that's part of the process of educating people so that they understand what they're getting. Or a ring or something like, you know, this is what has gone into it. One thing I didn't really talk about is that I do quite the instruction teaching high school kids and adults, mostly jewelry painting, drawing, art history, different, you know, lots of different. classes, and all of those, you know, taking a class, those students who go through the process of making a piece of jewelry and understand what does it do.
Mm-hmm.
And more often than not, we tell the customers, a lot of them point out it's just not for them, you know, like
yeah.
a class for fun or whatever, but for me, you know, work or whatever.
So you have a certain time, but a certain development stage that you take a picture and say,
yeah,
I want to develop this, I'm going to put this on, say, Facebook and see what the interest is?
Yeah. Oh, well, yeah, I definitely do that. I mean, if I end up using Instagram quite a bit more for inspiration than for, you know, actually getting sales.
Instagram. Yeah, me too. I know.
And I like Instagram because it's so visually, you know, like Facebook. Or a blog or something like that to where you know,
yeah.
you gotta write things. You know, like, take a picture, have a text, and then
yeah.
And then the other thing is you can do it just from your phone. You don't have to like download it onto your computer. So, and I find that, you know, with Facebook, you're sort of obligated to have all of your family and friends on there and take photos or photos of lunch and everyone's kids and everything else, and so I find that it's really more of a waste of time.
Thanks for
me. I've had to sort of learn to walk past my computer and go to work sometimes. It's easy for social media and website and emails and stuff like that to eat up your whole day. Go on there to answer, you know, check your email, and then it's 3 o'clock in the afternoon. It's like too late to go in the studio almost. So there's days where I just set aside to the point where I don't have any bed in the house.
Yeah, I was going to ask if you're a CBC listener.
Yeah, well, I am. Yeah, no, don't let me forget to tell you about podcasts and audiobooks and stuff. But I find that it's, you know, if you can really get sucked into on yourself at the point, that can be an issue. You really have to have the discipline to you know, say no to Facebook. When it's Facebook and you know you feel like you have to have all your friends on there, it can be a good opportunity to sell things. But for, you know, a social media pretty easy, I like Instagram because they've set it up so that it's not my friends, it's like things that I'm inspired by, it's other artists, it's work in progress, it's you know painters or whatever.
This is
like on my goal for inspiration rather than get sucked in and I'm like, oh, too much shit. Just like 3 hours and I feel like I'm wasting it.
Yeah. So do you, on your Instagram feed, put other things that you're interested in as well as really
Yeah,
stuff?
I do that to a limited extent. Most of the people that follow me are interested, follow me because they're interested in jewelry.
In your stuff. Yeah, oh, your jewelry or your stuff?
Yeah.
And what, there's a percentage of, if you find another artist inspiring, you would put in a picture of his work?
Yeah, I haven't explored that too much. I know that that's something that, like, if you re-gram something or repost something, that can be really beneficial for gaining more followers. And I don't really use my Instagram as a sales outlet. And sometimes it functions as that, but for me, that's kind of my thing, like, where I go to get inspiration or whatever, and I don't want to make it into a business. So, if it turns out that, you know, I do post things like, you know, most of my work in progress. Sometimes it's just to get feedback or just to be part of the community of the people who are on there and share the work in progress and inspire them to. So, you know, I don't know if that's good advice or not. I think that is undervalued to be part of a community, you know, to gain inspiration, to troubleshoot, to get feedback on things, to get tips on.
You were talking about that yesterday with the tribe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
the value of the
tribe. Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, I find you sort of underestimated. There are more things in the world. I'm a student. myself off for the outside world, and then, you know, down the road, I'm like, geez, what's missing? You know what I mean? I do something like a craft sale or a residency or something like that. Just being around, you know, other artists and craftspeople, I walk away a lot more inspired.
Mm-hmm. Well, it sounds, I like that, because you're not overvaluing the potential. You're saying, well, it could lead to something, but this is not where I put my energy to grow my business, which I think is really sort of smart to do. People don't know if they should do Pinterest or an Instagram or just Pinterest and Facebook and trying to link things together. So
well, another thing though is that I think it's authentic.
What is authentic when you do what?
When you're not using Instagram as a sense.
You're just
this is who I am and this is why I did it and I'm putting it out there. And if people are interested, then they're going to find it. But it's not like every second post is 1999, four equal installments.
Yeah.
You know, like sometimes I go audience, you know, and other artists even, you know, maybe Facebook, just you're looking at an advertisement and you go on there and I try to avoid that. And I think that the key, you know, sort of going forward, seeing small businesses that are just successful and independent craftspeople that are doing well, it's like, you know, they're people are attracted to them, to their lifestyle.
Yeah, exactly.
What they do. You know, seeing the successes and also the failures, like, another thing that no one likes to see when you go on social media is like someone complaining about everything that's going wrong in their life, or, you know, everyone goes through hard times and, you know, gets depressed and gets unmotivated and all of that stuff. But, and it's okay to, you know, be, you know, to share things like that, I think.
To what sense?
To like, in a limited sort of way. You know, and if there's other things that you're interested in, you know, other interests that you have to occasionally post that stuff. But it's the primary purpose of your Instagram is like to showcase your art, your pottery or something like that. It should be, you know, maybe 80 or 90% of what you post. People want to see that you're a real person too, you know, that you go on vacation, that you do other things, they have a life outside of work, like they have little pictures of your kids on there or something like that. But I think that it should primarily be your work. And then I also feel like on your profile there's a space for your website or your empty site or whatever, and people know where that is and they know where to find it. And you don't need to post, you know, every other post and be like, this is 20% off, and this is how to buy it, or whatever. That's sort of my strategy. I'm sure that there's people who are a lot better at the business side of it and really want to sell stuff that will, you know, go into that more. But what I find is that I end up selling, I'm just doing everything that I made.
So, I'm going to ask a question.
I'm just saying what everybody's thinking.
Basically. Oh, well, I'll just leave the room.
We're all thinking I had to go pee.
You talk about a lot of like some work and like people buying online and stuff like that. What's your experience when sending it in like mail and stuff? Like sending jewelry is very pricey, like things like go missing. What's your experience?
Yeah, that's why I brought that up, because I've had to develop kind of a policy around that. Because it's been overall a good experience. Most things arrive, depending on where you go. If you're shipping within Canada, I found things always tend to get there. And relatively quickly. shipping in the States is really fast. In fact, I live pretty close to the border, and I'll often hold on to things like that need to be shipped because it's cheaper and quicker for the customer to receive things if I take it across the border and ship it from the States, from Canada to something that's tracked. You know, it's going to take maybe 2 weeks to arrive at most locations in the States, sometimes a little quicker. But if I take it across the border, it'll be there in 2 days. Instead of $20, it's $2, and it includes tracking and insurance. It's just a huge difference. But that can kind of work against you if you ship it to the States, because you find that customers, American customers, expect things in 2 days. You know what I mean? Like, whatever they order, it's usually there. To California or something like that. If they order something from Canada, then, guaranteed in like 4 or 5 business days, they're going to be like, where's my thing? And so you have to sort of prepare them for that by sending them tracking numbers and letting them know it's going to be 8 days or something. So in terms of insurance, I find that it's usually a waste of time. I have gone missing. It's like there's so much red tape, and we get like first of all, you have to pay for insurance, and I kind of feel the way about insurance that I feel about like playing lottery or something like that. Like someone's winning, but it's not usually like the people who are paying into it. It's like, you know, the person who's guaranteed to win is always the house. It's like it's the casino. So whatever you pay into insurance, like the money that they pay.